Hello, this is the section 4.4 to 4.5 lesson. In section 4.3 we saw the so-called addition rule, which is a formula that allows us to calculate the probability that one event or a second event occurred in one trial of a procedure. In this section we're going to see what we call the multiplication rule, which allows us to calculate the probability that one event and a second event both occur in one trial of a procedure. To refresh our memory, the addition rule we saw in last section was stated as this: the probability of A or B is the probability of A plus the probability of B minus the probability that A and B both occur. We had to subtract the probability of A and B to make sure that we didn't double count anything. However, in the case where they were disjoint, meaning that they cannot occur at the same time, then the probability of A and B is zero. And so our formula simplifies down to this: P of A or B is PA plus PB. We don't have to subtract anything because we don't have to worry about double counting. The multiplication rules we're going to talk about in this section, and we'll state it formally here and then informally and do some examples of using it. Formally, it says the probability that A and B both occur in one trial of a procedure is the probability of A times the probability of B given that event A has occurred. This probability here on the right is what we call a conditional probability, and informally it's the probability of event B taking into account the previous occurrence of event A. So informally, what this multiplication rule is saying is to find the probability of A and B, multiply the probability of A by the probability of B, but make sure that the probability of B takes into account the previous occurrence of A. So we're going to multiply, but we have to be very careful about just exactly what numbers we multiply. So to illustrate this, let's look at this same table of data that we saw in the last section. Remember, this dealt with a marijuana drug test. This drug test was given to 300 people. They tested either positive or negative. And at the same time, they were asked, have you used or not used marijuana? So let's look at this procedure. Suppose we randomly choose two different people. Now that means we're going to choose one from the 300 and then a second from the remaining 299. We call this sampling without replacement, because you can think of it as though we choose one from the 300, do not replace it, and then choose a second from the remaining 299. We want to find the probability that they both tested positive. Well, the first thing in a problem like this is to just write down what it is we want to find in mathematical notation. So we're going to tell you the P of both tested positive. The second step is to rewrite that in terms that we know how to work with, specifically ands or ors. Well, if they both tested positive, that means the first tested positive and the second tested positive. That's equivalent to what we just said. Now we see the word and there, that makes us think multiplication rule. So I have to calculate the probability the first tested positive. Well, when I choose that first person, I have 300 to choose from, and a total of 143 of them tested positive. And so by rule 1, that probability is 143 divided by 300. Now I have to calculate the probability that the second person tested positive, taking into account the fact that I've already chosen one person that tested positive. Well, when I choose that second person, I've only got 299 to choose from. That's my denominator. Out of those, I only have 142 people left who tested positive. And so it's 142 divided by 299. And I multiply them and I get my probability, 0.226. So informally, in practical terms, this means that if I were to do this procedure a whole bunch of times where I chose two different people, about 22.6% of the time I'd get two people that tested positive. Well, now let's look at a slight variation on this procedure. Suppose we randomly choose two people with replacement. So that means I'm going to choose one person from the 300, and then I'm going to put that person back and choose a second person also from those 300. Find the probability that they both tested positive. Well, this is the same probability in words. Both tested positive means that the first tested positive and the second tested positive. Now, the problem, if the first tested positive, isn't going to be any different than the previous example. Got 300 people to choose from, 143 of them tested positive. So there we have that. So now I'm going to choose that person, but then I'm going to put that person back. So when I choose a second person, I still got 300 to choose from. I've still got 143 that tested positive. So there's the probability that the second person tested positive. I do that multiplication, I get 0.227. Now notice that's not very much different than the previous example, but technically it is different. Now, if you notice here in the first example, the two numbers that I multiplied weren't identical. They were very similar, but not identical. In the second example, they were identical. So what's the difference between these two problems? Well, in example one, our two picks or our two choices of people were dependent, meaning the probability of the second pick depended on what we got on the first pick. The fact that I had already chosen one person that tested positive affected the probability that the second person tested positive. In the second example, the picks were independent, which means the probability of the second pick did not depend on what we got on the first pick. After I chose that first person, I replaced it. Everything was right back to where it started. The fact that I already chosen one person had no effect on the probability of the second pick. Okay. So this leads us to our formal definition of independent and dependent. We say events A and B are independent if the probability of B, given that A has occurred, equals the probability of B. This is just a formal way of defining what it means that the one has no effect on the other. Informally, this definition says that they are independent if the occurrence of one does not affect the probability of the other. Now, if they are not independent, they are said to be dependent. Dependent is just the opposite of independent. Now, what's nice about independent events is that they simplify our formula, our multiplication rule. If they're independent, then the probability of B given A is the probability of B. And so our multiplication rule simplifies down to this. Probability of A and B is probability of A times the probability of B. We don't have any conditional probabilities involved here because everything's independent. So let's look at some examples of identifying independent and dependent events. So let's consider this procedure that we roll two different six-sided dice. Let's let event A be the event that the first die is a 2, and this event B be the event that the second die is a 4. Are they independent or dependent? Well, we have to ask ourselves, does the occurrence of one event affect the probability of the other? Well, they're two different die. One doesn't affect the other, so they would be independent. There's no connection between the two. Okay. Here's another example. A procedure, a car comes into an auto body repair shop. Event A is the event that the taillight is broken, and event B, the rear bumper needs to be replaced. Are A and B independent or dependent? Well, think about this. If the taillight is broken, that's an indication that maybe it got hit from the rear or it backed into something. So if that happened, then there's probably a good chance that the rear bumper needs to be replaced. So in other words, the fact that one of these events occurred does affect the probability that the other occurs. So we would say that they are dependent. Now, just because the taillight is broken does not necessarily mean the rear bumper needs to be replaced. However, the occurrence of one does make the occurrence of the other one a little bit higher probability. Another example of this type, a father takes his 4-year-old son to the park. Event A is that the boy sits on the bench and plays video games the whole time. Event B is the boy skins his knee. Are they independent or dependent? Well, if he sits on the bench and plays video games the whole time, it's going to be a lot less likely that he skins his knee. Likewise, if he skins his knee, that's an indication that maybe he didn't sit on the bench and played video games the whole time. He did something else. So they are dependent because the occurrence of one has an effect on the probability of the other. All right, let's look at one last example of identifying independent or dependent events, and then we'll do an example of making calculations with this type of procedure. A student sets two different battery-powered alarm clocks to go off at 7 a.m. Event A is that the first clock malfunctions, and event B is that the second clock malfunctions. Are they independent or dependent? Well, since they're battery-powered, there's really no connection between the two, so what happens to the first has no effect on the second, and so they are independent. Now, going along with this same example, suppose a stat student does not want to be late for class because of a malfunctioning alarm clock, so he decides to set three different alarm clocks. This is what we call redundancy. If the probability that any one clock malfunctions is 0.02, what is the probability that all three clocks malfunction? Well, again, to set this up, we need to first of all write down what it is we're trying to find. We want to find the probability that all three malfunction. We want to try to next restate that in terms that we know how to work with, namely ors or ands. Well, if they all three malfunction, then that means the first malfunctions and the second malfunctions and the third malfunctions. Well, these are just three different events that we looked at in the previous example, and we determined that they were independent. So using my multiplication rule for independent events, I can write this as the probability that the first malfunctions times the probability of the second malfunctions times the probability of the third malfunctions. That simplifies my work quite a bit. Now I know all three of those probabilities. Those are all 0.02. So I multiply 0.02 times 0.02 times 0.02, and I get my answer there. Very, very small probability. And that's really the whole point there. The probability that all three malfunction is much smaller than the probability that any one malfunctions. That's the whole idea behind redundancy. So to kind of summarize these rules that we've talked about, if we see the word or inside our parentheses, that suggests addition, but we have to make sure that nothing is double counted. If I see the word and, that suggests multiplication, but I have to make sure to take into account the occurrence of the first event when calculating the probability of the second event. Now next we want to go back and review a concept we talk about in section 4.2, and that's the complement. So the complement of event A, denoted A bar, consists of all outcomes in which event A does not occur. Informally, it's just the opposite of A. Now we mentioned that complements satisfy these rules here. The probability of the complement is 1 minus the probability of the event, and the probability of the event is 1 minus the probability of the complement. Now these properties are nice because sometimes I want to know the probability of an event A, but that's very difficult to calculate directly. It may be easier to work with the complement, calculate its probability, and then use this second rule to calculate the probability of A. So to illustrate that idea, let's look at this example. A procedure, we have three children and we're interested in their genders. Let's let A be the event that we have at least one boy. And stated in other terms, at least one boy means we have one boy or two boys or three boys. So if I wanted to calculate the probability of A, that's the probability of one boy or two boys or three boys. Now I see that keyword or there, that suggests addition. Next, I note that I can't have exactly one boy at the same time that I have exactly two boys at the same time I have exactly three boys. So these three events are disjoint. So I could write this as a probability of one boy plus the probability of two plus the probability of three boys. So I could, in principle, calculate these three probabilities, add them up, and I get my answer. So to do that, let's list the sample space here. If I have three children, I could have boy, 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 girl, boy, girl, boy, so on and so forth. I've got eight different events there. In exactly three of them, I have exactly one boy, so the probability of one boy is 3/8. Likewise, in exactly three of those events, I have two boys, so the probability of two boys is 3/8. And in one of those outcomes, I have exactly three boys, so the probability of three boys is 1/8. So now I can add 3/8 plus 3/8 plus 1/8 to get 7/8. So that's the probability of having at least one boy. Now, that's too much work. I don't want to have to calculate three individual probabilities and then add them up. So let's look at how we can use complements to simplify that work a little bit. So again, same procedure, same event. But now the complement that we have at least one boy is that we have no boys. The opposite of at least one is none. The probability of our event is 1 minus the probability of the complement. Now, the complement, in other terms, if I have no boys, that means the first is a girl, and the second is a girl, and the third is a girl. Now I see that keyword and, that suggests multiplication. But next I note that the gender of my three children are independent. The gender of the first has no effect on the gender of the second, has no effect on the gender of the third. So I could write this as the probability of girl times probability of girl times probability of a girl. Well, all three of those probabilities are 1/2, or at least we will assume that they're 1/2. And 1/2 times 1/2 times 1/2 is 1/8. 1 minus 1/8 is 7/8. So there's my probability. It's the exact same answer as what I just got. I just didn't have to do near as much work. I didn't have to calculate three individual probabilities and add them up. So again, this example illustrates the usefulness of using complements. It can simplify our work quite a bit. Now, along the same lines, let's look at this example. The MedTime company has delivered a batch of blood pressure monitors to a customer. The customer randomly selects three monitors and tests them. If at least one of them is defective, then the batch is rejected. This is a commonly used procedure called acceptance sampling. If 4% of the monitors are defective, find the probability that the entire batch will be rejected. Now, we might be tempted to say that the probability is 4% or 0.04 because four of them are defective. But as we'll see, the probability is actually much higher than 4%. Well, first let's just make a note here. If 4% are defective, that means that if we select one monitor, then the probability that it is defective is 0.04. That's just exactly what the 4% means. Now, along the same lines, the probability it is not defective is 1 minus 0.04, which is 0.96. Notice that not defective is the complement of defective, and so we use the properties of complements to calculate the second probability. So now, we want to know the probability that the batch will be rejected. Well, the batch will be rejected if at least one monitor is defective. Well, at least one monitor, that's kind of like the previous example. I don't want to have to deal with at least one, so let's instead deal with the complement. Well, the complement of at least one means that none is defective. Well, if none is defective, then that means the first is not defective, and the second is not defective, and the third is not defective. Well, these monitors are all independent. They're not connected in any way, so if the first is defective, that's not going to affect the probability of the second. And so I can write this using my multiplication rule for independent events. Probability that the first is not defective times the probability the second is not defective times the probability the third is not defective. Well, all three of those probabilities are 0.96, so I do that arithmetic, and I get 0.115. So there's about 11.5% chance that the entire batch will be rejected. So that's a lot higher probability. So the probability that the batch is rejected is much higher than the probability that one monitor is defective. In fact, it's almost three times as high. Alright, the last thing we want to talk about is conditional probabilities, how to calculate them, and what they mean in a practical sense. So we defined a conditional probability, P of B given A, as the probability of event B given that event A has occurred. So let's look at how to calculate them. Let's go back to this example of the marijuana drug test. And if one of the 300 test subjects is randomly selected, find the probability that the person tested positive given that he or she has actually used marijuana. So that means we select a person, and somehow we find out that the person has actually used marijuana. What's the probability that the person tested positive? Well, if we know the person has actually used marijuana, then we're not really dealing with one of the 300 people in general. We're only dealing with one of those people who have actually used marijuana. Well, a total of 122 of them have used marijuana, so that's going to become our denominator. Now, out of those 122 people that used marijuana, 119 of them tested positive, so that becomes our numerator. So 119 divided by 122 is 0.975. So we see there that the denominator comes from the second part of our conditional probability, namely that's the total number of people who have used. The 119 is the number of those who used who tested positive. Another example, same procedure, we choose one of the 300 test subjects, find the probability that the person used marijuana given that he or she tested positive. So like before, if we know the person tested positive, that means we're really only dealing with one of the 143 people who tested positive. That's our denominator. Out of those, 119 of them actually used marijuana. So we have 119 divided by 143, which is 0.832. Another example of the same type, find the probability that the person tested positive given that he or she has not used marijuana. So suppose we somehow figure out the person has not used marijuana, find the probability that they tested positive. Well, only 178 of those people have not used marijuana. Out of those, 24 people tested positive. So 24 divided by 178. That's our conditional probability. All right, now, what do these numbers mean? Well, the first one, the probability of testing positive given used equals 0.975, means that approximately 97.5% of those who have actually used marijuana will test positive. Now, that may be a little disturbing. You would think that if you've actually used marijuana, then you will definitely test positive. But tests like this are not perfect. They don't catch everybody, so it's not quite 100%. Close to 100%, but not quite. The probability of used given that they have tested positive is 0.832, means that approximately 83.2% of those who tested positive have actually used marijuana. Now, that one's probably really disturbing, because you think that if you test positive, it means for certain that the person has used marijuana. But as we see, that's not the case. It's only about an 83% chance. Again, that's because the test is not perfect. Our last one, probability of tested positive given that they have not used is 0.135, means that approximately 13.5% of those who have not used marijuana will test positive. So if you have not used marijuana, there's about a 13.5% chance that you will test positive. Again, you would think that that number should be zero. Think that if you have not used, then you will not test positive. But again, the test is not perfect. Now, let's give a practical application of these three probabilities. Let's suppose we have a high school of 1,000 students, and the principal thinks that there is a marijuana drug problem. But let's suppose that only 950 of those students have never used marijuana. Well, the probability of testing positive given that you have not used equals 0.135 means that 13.5% of those 950 students who have never used marijuana will test positive. Well, 13.5% of 950 is 128 students. So those 128 students will get what we call a false positive, meaning they get a positive result but they never used it. So we are going to falsely accuse 128 students of using marijuana. That's a lot of false positives. The probability of testing positive given that you've used equals 0.975 means that 97.5% of those students who have used marijuana will test positive. So 97.5% of 50 is about 48 students. So we're going to catch 48 students who have actually used marijuana. However, we're not going to catch two students, so two students will get off free. So we gave 128 false positives, we caught 48 students, and 2 students got off free. Those numbers aren't very good. This illustrates why we don't give tests like this to large groups of people, because we're going to get so many false positives, we're going to falsely accuse so many people, but yet we're still not going to catch everybody. So we only give tests like this to groups of people where we think there's a high probability that those people have actually used the drugs. So that's it for this section. The homework is section 4.4 to 4.5.